notice. I am Jacob Mafume, a spokesperson of the MDC Alliance. We have called this press conference at a very difficult time in the country. We have decided as a party that we need to address the nation on a few issues that are taking center stage at the present moment. With me, I do have our portfolio secretaries, our portfolio secretary for health, Dr. Madzorera. He is familiar to you. He was the Minister of Health during the inclusive government. He managed to deal with the health framework as it stands and managed to restore it from the level that it had been brought to at the time. Remember 2009, we had cholera epidemics, we had the collapse in the health sector, and part of his task as the minister then was to restore it to a level where it could provide services to patients, to a level where the health workers were able to get job certification, and also to create a regulatory environment that was conducive for the healthcare sector, in other words, to lay a foundation for growth. Which foundation he did lay, which job creation and job satisfaction he was able to manage. And that framework that he created during the time of the inclusive government is facing rapid collapse and is about to be collapsed. So he will be here to speak on issues of health. We've got Honorable Charosenga to speak on the Secretary for Labour. He's representing the Secretary for Labour. He will speak to the labour issues. The labour issues are not only related to the health system, they are spreading to all the sectors. It is our secretary, portfolio secretary for health. He will touch on a few points. And I do have Kagodora to my left. He is representing the portfolio secretary for education. We, as you are aware, every parent now is worried about going back to school. Children have to go back to school. The school fees is not clear what currents people are paying in. Other schools have adopted a hybrid system. The education sector itself, the workers there are not happy. They have met and said they will embark on an industrial action. It's not clear where the education sector is heading at all levels, from tertiary to primary levels. And it is something that we as a party have to address. We are faced with an unprecedented and escalating crisis, which is a legitimacy crisis, a leadership crisis, and the symptoms are coming out of the political crisis, economic crisis, social delivery, and labor unrest. Our president, Nelson Chamisa, will, in the next few days, address the nation on the issue of the agenda and address the nation over the new year and the projection and where we are going to go as a party and as a nation. Yes, he did give a Christmas address in Bari, and we urge you to get direction as to how this crisis will be solved. But at this juncture, it was felt by the party that it is important that the voice, an alternative voice, we are the alternative government, we are the government that ought to be sitting in the State House, that ought to be sitting in Mumutapa, and because of the theft, because of the rigging, because of what Mr. Chiwenga and General Mr. Mnangagwa and General Chiwenga did in taking over power without a handover. You will recall that they took over power, but there was no handover of power. So even the little knowledge that Mugabe had, they don't have. So they just took over like a child who takes over the remote when you are watching TV and starts chewing on the remote.
A child normally does not know what to do with the remote after having cried for it. They cried for the power, took it by force, and now have no clue as to what to do with it in the absence of a handover of the instruments of power and how to govern. So even the little knowledge that Mugabe had of governing the country, they don't have. And we are falling, and it's a race to the bottom, as it were. So at this juncture, the format of our process, we will have Dr. Madzorera speaking first on the issues of health, Honorable Tansenda speaking next on the issues of labor, short and brief, and Mr. Kakundora speaking again on the issues of education. Then we'll sum it up and then we'll get questions from the floor. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming and participating in our endeavor to normalize Zimbabwe and create, once again, a prosperous Zimbabwe. It is now 34 days since the doctors started their strike. What started as a junior doctor strike has now escalated to include radiographers, senior doctors, consultants, and government medical officers in the various districts. Promises that medicines and other consumables like gloves in hospitals will be made available by government remains a pipe dream. The dignity and welfare of doctors is yet to be attended to, and in the meantime, it is the ordinary Zimbabweans who are suffering and dying. We cannot even quantify the loss of life that is attributable to this industrial action and this general regression in our healthcare delivery system, because the patients are being turned away from hospital and they are dying at home, and we don't know how many are dying. The issue here, ladies and gentlemen, is an issue of the serious betrayal of our liberation struggle, the objectives of our liberation struggle, and we need to restore that. Furthermore, there is a real danger right now that if doctors are not treated with the respect that is due to them, we will likely see a devastating exodus once again of doctors and other healthcare workers. And this time it will be far greater than we have ever witnessed before. And each moment that passes without an agreement with the doctors increases the possibility of this exodus exponentially. It's important to point out that the right to health care of Zimbabweans, as enshrined in our constitution, has been trampled underfoot by this government, and that it is the singular responsibility of government to deliver this right to the people. It's not the responsibility of any individual in their individual capacity or from their personal wealth, including labor, to subsidize government to meet this inalienable right to health. Government collects taxes from the people, and government has a responsibility to distribute our tax revenues in a manner that allows every Zimbabwean to enjoy the highest possible level of health and well-being. The government cannot and should not hide behind a finger and blame doctors for this near complete collapse of the health sector. It is government's responsibility to allocate 15%, at least 15%, of total government expenditure to health, to manage additional earmarked taxes like the health levy, the AIDS levy, in a transparent and accountable manner that benefits all Zimbabweans, to deal with the corruption that is hemorrhaging not only the health sector, but the entire economy, and to start to improve the conditions in which our people are born and live and work and age. In other words, they must deal with the social determinants of health as a government. That way we'll create a healthier population. We no longer need mantras and slogans 1 year down the line. But we need genuine, tangible measures that improve the economy and the well-being of our people. We wish to agree with government that health services are a critical and essential service. Our country's leadership should not pay lip service to this fact, but should rather prioritize healthcare financing ahead of military spending and other spending. It is said that the ZANU-PF government is still holding on to ghost workers who are hemorrhaging the fiscus, while doctors and other genuine civil servants who are giving vital services to the nation are paid paltry salaries. We implore the government to show its commitment to the people's rights to health care by cleaning up the payroll, the government payroll. We note with concern that the government has consistently flouted its own agreements with the striking doctors, agreements made as far back as 2014. These agreements include a review of the on-call allowance and the payment of salaries in US dollars. This was agreed upon. We encourage the government to renegotiate these agreed upon terms in good faith if the government is failing to fulfill them immediately. We also urge the young doctors to agree to sit down with the government as and when the government decides to meaningfully engage them. Compromise from both sides is key to the resolution of this problem. Arrogance from either side will cost Zimbabwe a lot in terms of lives lost unnecessarily and health of our people permanently deranged. Government should not need doctors' strike to start buying essential medicines and hospital consumables. This is something they should do automatically and plan for on a day-to-day basis. We urge the government, therefore, to plan ahead and put in place concrete measures to ensure we get out of this bind and keep out of it for good. The entire health sector, including the private sector, is in a state of turmoil right now, with all medicines and basic essentials difficult to access because of issues of availability and affordability. People are now being asked to pay for medicines in private pharmacies in US dollars, which US dollars are no longer easy to get. We have reached a stage as dangerous as we reached in 2008, and perhaps even more dangerous, where diabetics, for example, died in 2008 in their large numbers because there were no basic medicines to sustain life for diabetics. We have already started experiencing shortages of all chronic disease management medicines, and we have started reversing all the gains we made over the last decade relating to key health indicators like maternal mortality, infant mortality, life expectancy, and so forth. We are regressing very fast. The least government should do is allocate enough forex for procurement of medicines alongside other essentials like fuel, because we have said health services are essential. They should have enough allocation of forex for medicines and consumables. And we must incentivize all health workers to continue giving this essential service. Ensuring that motor vehicles and fuel are available to doctors as a basic necessity is an important part of that incentivization. There is also the issue of retention allowances that health workers receive. These retention allowances come in US dollars. We strongly encourage government to pass on these retention allowances in US dollars as they come from the donors. In conclusion, the buck stops with the government. The government should stoop down to find common ground with the striking doctors before total collapse of the health service is upon us. We urge urgent accelerated dialogue between government and the health workers on industrial action. The nation should be reassured that government will prioritize health care and plan ahead to make medicines and health workers available at all times in adequate quantities and adequate numbers. the government should further move fast to craft and implement credible plans for universal health coverage financing. This is work that started way back in 2010, and we encourage the government to finish work on universal health coverage. That is what is going to ensure ultimately that we have happy health workers and that we have medicines and everything that we need in our hospitals all the time. And very finally, ladies and gentlemen, the matter we are talking about today is ultimately an issue of legitimacy. Unless the issue of legitimacy of the government is resolved, these problems are going to be very difficult to wish away. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor. We'll have the Secretary for Labour speak on the issues of labour in general.
I'm Honorable Darusenga, representing Honorable Shoko, who is the Secretary for MDC Labour. On his behalf, the labor is crying over the salary erosion that is caused by government mismanagement. What workers want is wages that are, or salaries that are pegged to the PDL, that is over the bottom line, which the current government is not prepared to pay. They are also not even prepared to negotiate, and they are negotiating in bad faith. So it's an issue that needs to be solved if workers of Zimbabwe can get decent wages. Workers also, always labor is affected in terms of transport and food costs. Transport is almost risen by 300%. People used to say from Chitungiza, they used to commute for 50 cents, but it has risen to $3 a trip, which is $6 to and from. So there is need for salary adjustments so that people would be able to commute to and from there. If, in the event that the government doesn't want to pay PDL wages, what is possible is for them to come up with the, or be able to come out with policies that protect what used to exist, say, before October 2018, because people were affording. But from October 2018 to date, that's where we started to realize all these unaffordable transport costs or food costs. So they must come up with policies that are able to, that workers will be able to sustain. There is also pension. Pensions have been eroded for the, because of bad policies that this government is provided. Pensions have been eroded twice now, during Gono's era, twice, and the third time is now that they are coming, they are, the pensions are also going to be eroded for the third time. So there is a need for government to come up with policies or rules that protect engineers, because every worker is there to work in order so that you prepare this exit. Which exit is the pension? So this pension that people are working, they are already eroded before people goes to pension. So it's wise that the government comes up with policies, or because these are contributor pensions. So there is a need to move away from contributor pensions to pensions that are determined. That means you actually know that when you go to pension, your pension is so much, which is a fixed pension. than to rely on contributors, because contributors would need these actuaries. Then actuaries would come up with all those figures which are vague, which would not be, which pension engineers would do, which will not be which will not sustain pensioners' lives after they are well. Then there is also the issue of informal sector. The informal sector, which we can say is the popular sector at the moment of our economy, in the popular sector. But it has got all these derogatory names, informal sector, vending sector, all those derogatory. But it is actually the economy that is withholding our economy. So what is needed is for the government to come up with policies that would resuscitate this economy, so that because the informal sector at the moment is the safety valve for workers, but there are no policies that sustain this sector, this popular economy. So there is need for the government to come up with policies that support the informal sector. I think with this words, I thank you.
Thank you, Honorable, for those words on the labor sector. And the last sector is on the education sector.
My name is Kagodora. I'm standing in for Honorable Atamisa, who is the secretary for our secretary for education. She's not around. So I'll be standing in for the MDC is a social democratic party and a labor-based movement. Would like to make the following pronouncements on the state of the educational sector. The MDC takes note, this is discussed though, that is the general decay of the education sector. We heartily empathize with the suffering majority of the teaching professionals who have continuously and faithfully discharged their duty under very difficult conditions with due diligence. We take note of failure by those who claim to be running the affairs of the Republic to proffer any meaningful solution to the crisis bedeviling the general educational environment, hoping that the return of ED from the short-lived relief will help remedy the crisis. We hope it's coming back to deal with that crisis. We take note of the continued skirting of key issues by the government, including dual pricing of services and goods that has threatened the delivery of quality education. Certain items are priced in US dollars at times, as Honorable Afume have said. Other schools are making part payments of school fees in US dollars, and it's not sustainable to the generality of the population. We take note of the continued skirting as we are dismayed by the continued criminalization of any form of action that the teaching professionals want to engage in order to remedy the situation. We have seen teachers who have mighty from Mutari in more than two occasions they've been locked up just for that job action. Our schools are opening next week, and we urge the government to sit down with the representatives of teachers to make a way forward and find common ground. We definitely hope this government, as it claims to be a listening government, we hope they are going to listen to the pleas by the teachers. Indeed, teachers have made their grievances known in a very unforgettable manner. Some of their representatives walked hundreds of miles to bring their plight to the attention of the nation. And we strongly believe ED and this government are going to listen to the teachers. And as a way forward, we hope this government will engage all the stakeholders that are involved in the educational system. And we call for the government to immediately start paying teacher salaries denominated in US dollars or the US dollar equivalents, so that the teachers can hedge their income against inflation. We hope and we call on this government to engage all stakeholders in the education sector with an attempt to bring a long-lasting solution to the sector and stop victimization of the educational professionals. We call upon this government to stop demilitarizing the education sector. We have seen of late that soldiers are being sent to schools and harassing the headmasters and threatening the teachers to come back to work. We urge the government to stop that. We hope the military personnel will remain in the barracks. And we also expect this government to bring back the grant to university students. Because this is a necessity. The parents cannot afford as things change. And the government must help in that area. And in order to remedy the already overburdened parents, primary education must be declared free with immediate effect. The secondary education, so that all children can go back to school. Because what we are seeing now, from now going forward, most likely we are going to have dropouts starting January as schools are open. So we expect this government to respect that right for the children to go to acquire education, and also to respect the teachers' right to equitable remuneration.
Thank you very much. I don't know if there are questions that we can answer before we conclude on this. These aspects that we have spoken about. Yes.
And my question is directed to Mr. Madzorera. In regards to the issue of junior doctors, we understand that the government has advertised for new applications for those students that have just qualified as teachers, but they have no experience. What are the effects if they are to be deployed because they need supervision? They don't have any experience in that field. What are the effects to hospitals, to patients actually?
Thank you. Can I answer?
Yeah, sure. Well, maybe we can take two.
Yeah. This question is directed to Dr. Madzorera. You were there during the inclusive government as Minister of Health. From what you saw in the way the government was being run, what is it that you can point out that is being done wrong by the current regime, which can be done much better, maybe if they listen to the concerns of the general public?
Mine is a follow-up to her question. My name is Lucy Yassini. It's directed to Dr. Madzorera. Can you share with us what is the proper procedure when one graduates as a medical student, as a medical doctor, and then are they automatically thrown into the deep end that they should carry out their work as a doctor? What is the procedure? Maybe if you could share with us on that as a doctor.
So the first and the last questions are related. When a medical student qualifies, they become a doctor immediately. You become a doctor by virtue of your qualification from the university, you know, your Bachelor of Medicine, Bachelor of Surgery degrees. I've heard some people questioning that, but there is nothing to question. Once you've qualified, you choose what you want to do in life. If you want to continue as a doctor in life, then you must do housemanship or internship. Internship is done under the Ministry of Health in an approved hospital where internship can be done. This means in a hospital where you have the supervision of a consultant and you have other middle-level doctors, you know, senior registrars, senior house officers, and so forth, supervising you. So you have 3-4 layers of doctors supervising you as a houseman or an intern. A houseman is not qualified to work alone. They have to report to some senior doctor. And so this recruitment of doctors who have just qualified, when all senior doctors, from senior house officer to the consultant, are on industrial action, is very mischievous. because these young doctors are not qualified by law to practice independently. After finishing your housemanship, then you'll be put on a register by the Medical Dental Practitioners Council that allows you to practice medicine independently. So this is pure mischief. They are trying to circumvent a problem that they have, but the solution they are proffering is not credible. It won't work, and these doctors could even refuse to work under those conditions. They should, in fact, refuse, because there is some legal liability that may follow that. If things happen while a houseman is functioning alone without supervision, then that houseman is completely responsible for their actions. They have no superior to shield them. So that is the simple answer to that. I hope I've answered both. Then you wanted to know what has gone wrong in the health sector, which can be improved. I think the health sector is very much dependent upon the entirety of government. So you cannot take the health sector and pull it out on its own and say, let it function. It depends on the economy, it depends on the leadership. I pity the Minister of Health right now and the entire health staff, because they are operating under conditions which are really suboptimal. They don't make the final decisions. They don't decide about the economy. The health sector is not a money-generating a sector. It is a social sector that consumes money. Health, education, social welfare, those sectors consume money and they depend on government. So what should the government do? The government should allocate enough resources, minimum from the budget of 15%. That is agreed upon, but they are not honoring that. Then after that, let's let them take good care of the levies that are already there. We want to see transparency, we want to see those levies working before we can even think about how we can make that place bigger. So during the inclusive government, we had a lot of goodwill from the international community, but this goodwill is not exactly there right now because of the issue of legitimacy which we mentioned. The government must show seriousness and clean up the issue of legitimacy of the government in order to be able to tap deeper into the goodwill of the international community.
Yes, just as a follow-up, you alluded to the fact that the challenges that they are facing, some of it going to the issue of the fiscal, whether the government has got enough resources or not, because these are sectors that consume instead of generate income. But what do you then make of the recent outcry whereby MPs, including those from MDC, they've actually made demands that are so outrageous, according to members of the public? The cars, the golf, the meals, internet, and so they made demands of so many things. And if you then look at the budget, you find that so much money will now be diverted to the welfare of the MPs, including some from MDC. What do you then make of that? Because people out there, they are now saying, these MPs, they are not sincere.
Well, I'll take that. The Honorable Temba Muliswa, who spoke about some of the exotic things, does not speak on behalf of the MDC caucus. He speaks on his own behalf as an independent MP, and he came in as such. And our MDC caucus speaks on its own in terms of its welfare issues. Yes, the welfare of the MPs, like everybody else's welfare, has to be looked at and will be looked at. But it will not be looked at in contradiction to the people suffering. It will not, our caucus will not push a position that is insensitive, that is in contradiction, that is extravagant to the suffering of the people. It will look at those conditions that will enable it to allow it to carry out its duties as a parliamentary caucus. But Temba Muliswa, or Honorable Temba Muliswa, does not speak for our caucus, and the things that he spoke about
are not issues that were raised by our caucus. Our caucus has got its set leadership that speaks for it in terms of the welfare issues. And I assure you, seafood is not one of the demands that our caucus wants to have for its parliamentarian. And we do not eat it, even if the other people want to have seafood as part of the world. So, back to the issue at the end. Are there any other questions?
Yes. You made reference to the issue that we are addressing legislation in the words. National AIDS Council recently raised the red flag where they were saying they have 25 million in their coffers for them to buy 25 million bonds. But they can't buy ARVs. And this sector is now concerned that if those people are going to default on ARVs, it's going to be a disaster. What would be your advice to them?
Well, my advice is really... Can I take this?
Yes, yeah, you can take it. It's right up your leg.
You see, what government did is wrong. 12 months ago, if I had $25 million in my account, that was equal to $25 million US dollars. And that's what they told us in 2016, that it will be one-to-one. And we told them we've been down this path before, and we have seen inflation catching up. Now they've separated bond note from US dollar, and effectively dividing. Now $25 million now is $25 million divided by 4. Which is 6.25 million. Effectively, that's what it is. Which is unfair, it's daylight robbery. It has been done to all of us, including the National AIDS Council. And I cannot speak a lot to that because it's a national crisis. Perhaps Mr. Mafume will talk to that. But my advice to government now is, let them consider the health sector separately. Let them change that $25 million because it's our money that we contributed as US dollars. Let them give $25 million US dollars to NAC to procure medicines. That sort of affirmative action for an important sector like health should be done. They should change it to US dollars. You can't import medicines using bond notes. And the effects, you talked about the effects of defaulting on ARVs, the effects are catastrophic. If our patients started defaulting now, we're going to have a huge mass of Zimbabweans who are resistant to the first-line treatment, which, number one, is the best treatment with the least side effects, is the most effective. And if we have a huge mass of Zimbabweans who are resistant, who want now the second-line treatment, which is more expensive, $25 million won't go very far if half our patients will need to go on second-line treatment. We are making treatment very expensive, and that is not wise. Therefore, we urge government to make sure that NAC gets its US dollars and procures medicines.
Yes, sir.
Maybe from my observation, what we have said is already shared and experienced by the 69th movement. And maybe their interest now is to know you as an alternative government, what are you offering? What's the way forward? Because from everything that you have shared, this is what already been experienced and shared by the people. But they are looking up to you to say, what's the way forward? What are you going to do? What's going to happen?
Okay. All right, so in conclusion, probably we'll conclude with that. The way forward is very clear. It has been enunciated by our president, President Advocate Nelson Chamisa. We have anchored the way forward on the five-point plan. The five-point plan, which is a path back to the restoration of normalcy and legitimacy for Zimbabwe. Now, the five-point plan begins with a national dialogue. There has to be a national dialogue. A national dialogue where the parties have to speak to each other, a genuine national dialogue. Our government is trying to talk over, above, and under everybody else and not talking to the people. We have legitimacy issues and there is need for national dialogue that has to be anchored on a genuine a solution, and that has to deal with issues of national healing, looking at those that have been harmed, those that have suffered. Recently we've had seven people were shot in cold blood in the streets of Harare. That is part of the national healing. Some of the issues that were raised in the Moshante Commission were that these have to be investigated. No investigation has been launched, nothing of that sort. The international community is watching, the local community is watching, and if the people are shielded from accountability on issues that would have happened in broad daylight, then it's difficult to talk about issues of legitimacy. Then the key issue is we have to anchor our solutions on reforms. Reforms, reforms, reforms. We have to reform. And we have to reform the economy, we have to reform the politics. We have to reform the politics in the sense that we have to align the laws to the constitution. We have to align the laws, we have to have an electoral system that works, an electoral system that counts the proper votes, an electoral system that counts in timeously and announces timelessly. Even in the Moshante Commission, defective as it was, it came up and did not see any reason why results should take more than 24 hours to announce, why certain issues in terms of the electoral framework are done the way they are done in Zimbabwe. The reforms has to be done. Media reforms. We have one radio station that has different names. It calls itself Star, it calls itself Provincial Radio Stations. All of these are coming from one umbilical cord. We have one TV station, the only nation to have one TV station in Africa. Even those countries who are at war have more TV stations than us. So there's no media reforms to talk about. We have to have the economic reforms. Economic reforms, our president has spoken time and time again about the economic reforms that need to be done. We need to have a clear position on currency issues. We need to have a clear position on fiscal issues. We need to have a clear position on corruption issues. We need to have a currency that makes sense. The fiction, 1:1, is not working, even for government. They are now moving around from sector to sector, providing money for beer, and they can't provide money for doctors. The next day, they are providing money for water chemicals. They can't provide money for this. We cannot have a bone-throwing economic policy that is dependent on which sector has cried the most. A sector that screams the most is the sector that is given money. One wonders why the doctors are not being given money, yet they are crying the most. This is primary, basic, and we need to make rational decisions. You cannot say a doctor is no longer an employee simply because you don't want to pay them. It's like saying a person who wants to assert the right to life, you'll have Chiwenga coming up and saying, no, we've discovered a loophole, you are not a person. So therefore, we can't give you the right to life. We've now made studies with other people, even when it's hot, we've made studies with other people and discovered that you are not a human being, therefore we are not going to give you the right to life. I mean, that is the level at which this government is reasoning. A person has been an employee for years and years. We've known that junior doctors are employed for years and years. And today, somebody comes up and says, I've discovered that you are not an employee. So we need a rationality in our decision making and in our economic affairs. Demonetizing of the bond security around the RRTGS balance, probably ending and abolishing the quasi-fiscal activities of the Reserve Bank, the treasury bills that have become, abolishing the usurious 2% tax that taxes you over and over again per every transaction. So you end up losing your money to the state. It taxes you over and over again. You get paid $500. When you take it out to pay rent, you are taxed. When you take it out to give your mother in the rural areas, you are taxed. When you pay out to buy bananas, you are taxed. Even when somebody sends it back to you, you are taxed. This is usurious. This is downright thievery by the Minister of Finance. He cannot keep stealing from the people as he is doing. So we need that to stop immediately. We need to re-engage with the international community on a basis that is rational, where the international community will comply with international norms and standards, and therefore we are able to tap into international finance, we are able to have foreign direct investment as a way forward. And that needs to be done as a matter of agents. And it cannot be done when we are not talking to each other. We've put the issue of dialogue out there. The president has spoken about it. Our leadership has spoken about it. Yet we have not received any reciprocal desire to dialogue by the current illegitimate regime. But once we put that cocktail, that five-point plan is enunciated by the president, that is the solution and that is the proposal as an alternative government that we have as to the way forward. And we had brought here the former Minister of Health, who has done it before and done it successfully, that we do have the capacity within our ranks and within the nation of individuals and people who will be able, once we deal with the legitimacy question, be able to come in, and it will be all hands on deck. They have the capacity, we have done it before, they've done it before, and we are able to restore this nation in a short space of time through a transitional framework that restores democracy and legitimacy. And that is all we are proposing as an alternative government. But however, this is what we have said in brief, as I have indicated earlier on, that our president is due to give a statement in the coming few days on the way forward and a more comprehensive solution to the crisis that we are currently in. Failure which the citizens have a right to express themselves, have a right to demonstrate, have a right to collective action, have a right to express themselves in terms of Section 59 of this Constitution in any manner that is constitutional, to bring to attention the fact that we need solutions. So in the absence of meaningful dialogue, people will have to resort to the Constitution and collective action that ensures that their voices and solutions are provided. Thank you.